We've got with us Charles Fun, who's the CTO of Cheetah Mobile. And I think this is the first time you've been with us, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Happy to be here.
Okay, so we're going to try to make mobile relevant. Obviously, lots of you are not directly in the mobile business, but I think by the end of this session, you'll see why the things Charles has got to say are actually relevant to all of us. First of all, why don't you explain what Cheetah Mobile does, what
Sure.
the product line is, and...
Sure. So Cheetah Mobile, for those of you who have not heard of us, we are a mobile app company. We are 6 years old, started in 2010, but we have grown pretty quickly. Now on Google Play, we are the third largest app developer after Facebook and Tencent. We have over 600 million monthly active users worldwide. Even though we started from China, our business is worldwide. So over 80% of our users are from outside of China. And our apps range from utility apps that we produce an app called Claymaster that has over 200 million users around the world that help clean your phone, make your phone run faster. We have also recently developed a What's Call app that allows you to make free phone calls worldwide. That's been very popular among the migrant workers and refugees around the world. We have PhotoGrid, which is a photo editing tool. And we expanded beyond the utility apps and start developing the content apps, as well as the gaming apps now. So we were born in the mobile internet, and we're still doing mobile apps.
Okay, now we're gonna show them why you're the CTO. let's talk about the internet.
Sure.
And its evolution, where it's been, and more importantly, where is it going?
Sure. So it's great to be at PTC. It's such a great location and great people and such a relaxing environment allow us to interact. But to be honest, I know very little about the carrier business, the undersea cables. I know they exist, but that's it. But I have been, you know, really taking advantage of the infrastructure that all of you have built. Because I have a job today because of the internet, and the internet exists because of the infrastructure that was put in place. And certainly in the last 25 years, there is no other technology that has changed our society more than the internet. It's actually such a fundamental change that I think it's once in 100 years. Because really what differentiates humans from other animals are really two things, I believe. The first is our ability to connect and collaborate as a large group. Animals can collaborate in a small hordes, but we can collaborate at the scale of millions or even billions of people. And that's really a unique capability of human beings. And the second is our ability to process information, our ability to generate information, to transport information, to store information, to compute information, and to build our knowledge on top of all these information. And in both of these dimensions, I believe internet was a quantum leap. It allowed us to connect to each other in a very different way, much more efficient than the methods before. You know, the last time this happened was probably when the printing press was invented 600 years ago, and the internet is really the next big thing that happened there. And it completely redefined how information was collected, collaborate. And the second dimension is it completely redefined how information was collected, how information was transported, how information was processed, and how information was stored. So in both of these dimensions, internet was such a once in a 100-year change. And it's no surprise it changed every industry. Now, initially, it started by democratizing the business of publishing. So before, it's not easy to get your work published. You have to beg a publisher and so on. But ever since the internet came about, it's really easy for every one of us. And Gary was just sharing with me how he writes every morning and gets published to millions of people every day. And that's unimaginable 30 years ago, before the internet came about. And with the democratization of publishing, it started this dominoes that changed one after the other. With search, the information is organized in a very efficient way that with a search term, any knowledge can come to your eyes within the matter of a few milliseconds. And then after search, it comes the social network that really redefined the human relationships. In addition to what's underlying and not being displayed in terms of how you like certain people, how you dislike certain people, what's the level relationship you have with them, social network actually made everything explicit. It just lay in front of you because the underlying infrastructure that was put in place. And then with mobile internet, the device starts to follow you everywhere. You don't have to go to the device, but the device comes with you. So that, again, changed a lot of things. So over the last 25 years, I think just wave after waves of impact from this thing that's called internet has caused.
Now, this is an audience that knows very well, as I do personally, yes, the business model changes that the internet tends to bring with it. Are you thinking that we may be on the cusp of new business models that we haven't thought of yet? And yeah, how will the internet actually change in terms of how it operates and what the core technologies are?
Sure. Clearly. Maybe just starting from the last 25 years. And by the way, somebody calls it the first half of internet. So we are kind of in a halftime where what's coming up is the second half of this soccer game that's the internet. In the first half, clearly a lot of the business models that have been impacted. And it's not only the consumer facing, but also the enterprise facing as well. For example, I think we heard about cloud and big data. And those are really new enterprise business models, but it really was initiated by the internet technology as well. Without internet, cloud would not have existed. It's the consumer-facing data centers that paved the way of the possibility of this new enterprise IT servicing model that the functionalities are supplied a network away rather than from your own data center. So that's one good example would be in cloud. And in the last few years, we have this concept of O2O, such as Uber or Airbnb, and it'll be more, DoorDash, where whether it's your going out, whether it's you go finding a place to stay in the island of Oahu or anywhere else, or you want to find a meal, the internet provides a new way how the physical services can be delivered to you. So those are some of the good examples of the business model shifts that happened in the first half of the internet. Now, what's coming up in the next 25 years, in the second half? So I'm sure all of you have heard the new buzzword, AI. It seems for 2016, that's the buzzword of the year. And I have been actually exposed to AI through my work at Cheetah Mobile. You might be wondering why. Why does a mobile app developer have to worry about artificial intelligence? The reason, I'll start from high level, and then I'll go down to exactly how we are interacting with AI and why I think that's really the key technology trend of the second half of the internet, and that's going to change a lot of the business models. So at the highest level, I believe internet so far have presented us with new ways of transporting and organizing and made information accessible to us, but it never had a heart or a brain. Essentially, the initiator of this information are the devices and humans behind those devices. The internet works at our fingertips. Now AI, what AI does is it gives the brain to the internet. It allows internet or the machine to initiate actions. You know, it's a little scary, but I think it's true, and we need to deal with every aspect of it. It no longer makes internet passive to the human beings behind it, but it gives life to this internet that we have created. And so that's a high level statement I would make. And then how it impacts, you know, a little company like Cheetah Mobile. So even though we are the third largest app developer, we are still a young and relatively small company with about 2,000 people and working on a few apps. But the new app that we are doing is called News Republic. And it is a content aggregation and personalization app. It collects content from everywhere. We have partnership with about 2,000 content publishers, you know, news agencies, etc. And we started a platform called Spark that is trying to attract all individual content creators, whether bloggers or YouTubers. You know, if you're creating content, you're welcome here. And then we, using the artificial intelligence machine learning technology to personalize all these content to every individual who are using the app. And so that the content are arranged in the best way we can predict what information the person needs at that moment. And this is without the person entering a search term or entering any information. So this app become an active being that whenever you open your phone, it will have the information we think you need right on the phone in front of you, even before you log in, that you can see the, if you get up in the morning, you can see the weather today, you can see where you might want to go and how the traffic. You might want to know, you know, if I like table tennis, you'll have the table tennis news of the day. And I'm sure Gary is a big surfer, and you know, you'll see this is happening in the surfing world. And how do we know about this information? This is all based on the data. So data is really the oil or the blood of this life. And there are more and more ways those data can be collected from every individual. And even from, you know, your interaction with the phone as you've been using this app. The more you use this app, the more we know about you as well. So with this little simple application of AI, we were able to create an active information app that without you prompting it, it you know, basically pushes the information in front of you. So that is one example, you know, how a app developer starting to using the AI technology to deliver what's next in the information dissemination. Now, why this year? Why suddenly AI become a buzzword? Is because in the last year, there was some significant milestone in the AI technology itself that made something that wasn't possible before possible today. You know, one thing that's maybe insignificant to many of us, but it's certainly significant to two group of people, the AI experts and the Go, the game of Go enthusiasts, is for the first time now machine defeats human players, the best human players in the game of Go, which is known to be a very complex game and that has been out of the grasp of the machines. And the technology that enable it is something called deep learning or deep neural networks. A neural network is not new. It's been around for 30 years. But over the last few years, the increasing amount of data available and the increased amount of computation power suddenly make possible a much bigger, more layers of these neural network neurons or perceptrons to be connected together and created amazing results. The first breakthrough happened about 5 years ago in a contest that is to finding cats in pictures. You know, before that, human always beat machines by a large margin. Humans, on average, can find cats correctly from any pictures, whether they're a cat or whether no cat, by the probability of 95%. So 95% of the pictures, human can identify correctly. machines, you know, 5 years ago can only do that 70-80% of the time with the best algorithms created by the smartest people. But with deep neural network, suddenly the machine can do 97%. So it can find, it has a higher level of cognition from computer vision perspective than human eyes or human brain. So that started a wave of breakthroughs. It started to outperform people in seeing things, and then it started outperforming people in hearing things. So now in speech, in fact, machine can outperform people in converting voices into text as well. And then the breakthrough happened last year. Now, besides AlphaGo, who beats the Go player, another big jump happened in machine translation. Now, Google translation has been okay, has been useful. I've been using Google translation from time to time. But in the February of 2016, it wiped out all of the previous algorithms that it's been creating for the last 10 years and replaced the whole thing by one 8-layer neural network. And amazingly, that created a huge jump for the qualities that Google Translate was able to do. And not only does it create this jump in the translation quality, but another interesting effect is before the neural network technology was in place, Google Translate has to have 10,000 models. So why 10,000 models? Because it needs to translate from 100 languages to 100 languages. So you have to do 100 times 100. So you have to, for every pair, you need to create an algorithm to do the translation. But with deep neural network, interestingly and magically, there seems to be an underlying language model that is not even comprehensible by human that was created. So if I was able to do a, you know, English to Korean translation and a Korean to Japanese translation, then actually the underlying model allows you to do an English to Japanese translation as well. So you only have to do the order of n rather than the order of n square models in doing all these language to language translations. So clearly some wonderful technology breakthrough is happening in the area of AI that really opened up new possibilities, and that is the reason AI suddenly became at the forefront of the technology breakthroughs in really adding this new brain and new heart to the internet.
Yeah, so the first wave of the internet began to disrupt media.
Yes.
And basically carving the revenue out of it,
yes.
Way the profit.
Yes.
So it's good, but it has consequences that aren't so good for human beings who work.
Yes.
In this next phase, what I'm hearing you say is the things that human beings do that can be reduced to an algorithm, the machines are going to do better.
Yes.
And there's parts of almost every job that every human does that's reducible to a recipe. So algorithms seem to have power, but is there anything that's more powerful than algorithms?
Okay, that's a great question and a very...
And we got about four minutes.
4 minutes. A very good observation. Yeah, I tend to talk a lot when I...
That's good.
...on a topic that I'm interested in. So so that's a great question because the internet started by really democratizing publishing. And AI, in some ways, started now by democratizing algorithms. So before, you know, there are the powerhouses, the Googles and Facebooks and the tech, IBMs, Microsoft, the technology powerhouses were able to hire thousands of PhDs and they can create better algorithms than a little startup could or all of us could. Now, in some ways, AI, if our prediction is true, is going to change the game. It's going to bring everybody back to the starting line. Essentially, you know, the work of 100 PhDs from Google Translate will suddenly be replaced by a simple, relatively simple neural network model. And now algorithm is just that model. And then how you improve it is less in the algorithm itself. So you don't really need the 100 PhDs anymore. But what you need are the people, two type of people. The first type is who can better feed data into this model. So really, data becomes the differentiator to the performance of an algorithm. It's rather than the algorithm themselves. So that really changed the game, and that sort of give, you know, maybe entering a different game. It becomes a game of data there. And then the second thing that's important is really the underlying computing infrastructure. Now, some of you, especially if you invest in stocks, might have noticed NVIDIA was doing really well. They were the number one performing stock on S&P 500 in 2016, and their stock more than tripled last year. And why? One word, AI. Two letters, AI. So it's because they made a very visionary decision of exiting the ARM business and go all in on AI. And because AI, or particular deep learning, is all about matrix or vector computation. And the graphic GPUs are very good in doing those matrix computations. So that became a new application for the GPUs, and they became very successful. So data and computing are really the two differentiating technologies or technology areas that how people compute. So it does change the game. Now, if we go a little further along, I was just joking with Gary. So for those of you who don't know, I've always been an engineer, and Gary is more creative. He's the artist, the writer, you know. I say in the future, there'll be less jobs for me and more jobs for him.
But we won't get paid.
You know, the reason is it's foreseeable the job that is repetitive, that is about finding patterns out of things and categorizing and you know, drawing conclusions from these patterns will all be replaced by machines. So all repetitive mind work will be the first to be replaced by machines. So there will be less engineering jobs, I think, if those engineering jobs or other knowledge worker jobs that just require repetitive actions. But it will be much longer or never for the more creative jobs, you know, for the people who are asking the questions to be replaced by machines. So I think for anything, the question is known. And all we have to do as humans is to provide the answers. It's conceivable that machines will do that much better than humans sooner or later, probably sooner. And for those that require you to ask the questions, I still don't know whether a machine can ever replace human.
Yeah, so the conclusion here is that even if algorithms get dethroned as the source of value, yeah. Google, Facebook, the data that they own is going to be the new source of value.
So there will still be scary giants, not because of their PhDs, but because of the data they have.
Okay. Yes. So, Charles, thank you very much. Quite enlightening. Thank you.
Thank you.